Okay. So I'd like to introduce our panel members first. So this is the last session of the day, but I think also one of the best sessions of the day, an opportunity for the questions you have to get put to the experts. So I have a number of questions up here. I'll try and direct to who may be the most appropriate person to answer, but I think the panel, I'm speaking to you all now, feel free to, if you have comments or other answers you'd like to provide, to jump in. So the panel members begin on the far left with the distinguished Dr. Ronan Foley, from a hematologist from the Jurevinsky Cancer Center, and I actually would... Yes. I think he's told everybody here who he knows how much he's taught me over the years. It turns out it's actually true. I can't even come back with anything. So, but I do want to acknowledge one important thing, and that is that for the first three of the four of these meetings, Ronan was the medical chair and has been a great contributor and asset to these meetings and to the CLL PEG. If we could just give a quick round of applause for his. Next to Dr. Foley, we have Dr. Johnston, who we've all met earlier on today. And next to him is Susan Leclair, who is from the University of Massachusetts Dartmouth, also a big friend to the CLL PEG in this meeting, having participated in many meetings earlier, and is giving a talk tomorrow that we eagerly anticipate around prognostic markers. I can't actually see who's next. Oh, yeah. So next is Dr. Nicole Lamanna, who we're also going to hear more from tomorrow. She's one of our key speakers for tomorrow morning. Dr. Lamanna is a hematologist at Columbia University, and he has come up from New York to join us. We're very excited to have her here and to share her wisdom tomorrow around when and how to treat. Next is somebody, I can't remember who he is. Dr. Keating. and finally, on the far end, Dr. Gibson. So that is our panel. All right, so bear with me as we try to make our way through the questions. There's a couple of specific questions actually around FCR that might be a good place just to start. The first question around FCR treatment, so I'll read them verbatim. So if neutropenia and thrombocytopenia develop during FCR treatment, subsequent rounds are postponed week by week until the blood picture recovers. How long can subsequent rounds be delayed before the benefits of earlier rounds are lost or reduced? So we may as well ask the pioneer of FCR to begin. Dr. Keating.
Tech people. You know, one of the things that we tend to forget is how the FCR program was developed was very arbitrary. We commonly use 3 or 4 week cycles of therapy in all sorts of cancers. And many of the patients that we see come back every 3 to 6 months. So that we sort of stuck to a schedule. But one of the things that I tell my patients is that CLL has taken years to develop. Whereas it's important in the acute leukemias where the cells are recovering and growing rapidly, takes a long time to build up more CLL cells. So if you're going to err on any side, don't err on the side of getting it in as quickly as you can. Give the patients plenty of time. they're not losing anything. The same question came up with ibrutinib today, that a lot of people that have some side effects are terrified to go off the drug just in case something explosive will happen. And I think we need to remember that with ibrutinib, the early studies, they were on the drug for 2 or 3 weeks, and then they had a week rest. So the white count would go up, and it'd go down, and go up, go down, etc. But the trend was always down, and no one ever lost anything. So that rather than push people into the possibility of getting infections because of incomplete recovery, just take your time. There's no hurry with CLL. It gives us a little more time to get to the point where we can get the cure in place anyway.
Great. The next question is about ibrutinib treatment. Will ibrutinib eventually be used with untreated patients? I don't know. What do you think, Ronan? Do you want to take a stab at that one?
Well, I mean, it's have been people in the room who have had frontline ibrutinib. You know, I we're learning more about it, who it's really working in. It's a pill. It's got really all of the things that make it a magic bullet. The atrial fibrillation and understanding the platelet issues and bleeding and what to do with people with atrial fibrillation should they be on a, they're not supposed to be on warfarin in Canada, but can they be on warfarin or can they be on one of these newer anticoagulants? So there's, like anything, nothing's free. You know, there's always something with new drugs that you have to be aware of. But I, you know, I certainly think when you saw Dr. Keating's slides there and the difference between people on ibrutinib and the ofatumumab, it really is quite remarkable stuff. And if it works that well in relapse setting, you know it's going to be pretty amazing as front line. So I certainly can see it heading in that direction. Just before I go on, though, you know, my jaw almost fell off when I walked in the room here and I saw CLL PAG is strong, CLL PAG is good. This is quite a remarkable turnout, and I do have to thank Dr. Fraser for taking over from me. I got too busy, but it's great to see faces here, and your strength is remarkable, and it's going to serve you well in the future as we go forward. So I do want to, I'm sure you'll thank him at some point, but I do want to thank Dr. Fraser for taking this over, and you've got a hell of a good leader here.
I wonder if any of the other panel members just wanted to speak to ibrutinib in front line.
I guess I'm not, I don't know about the sort of long-term side effects with ibrutinib, and I guess that's, there's, with every new drug, there's all this enthusiasm. I had a mentor at one point. Says on, can you hear me? I had a mentor at one point, and he said, whenever a new drug came along, you should use it as quickly as possible, because after 2 years, it starts having side effects. And I always remember that, and I guess that that's sort of one of my concerns, is that whenever a new drug comes along, you know, new drugs always look terrific at the beginning, and then we realize that they do have some failings. And I actually was more impressed by Dr. Keating's slides when he showed the long-term remissions of patients who had been on FCR. And if you have a 40 to 60% chance of being in alive and well 15 years later after treatment, I think that's a great thing, and you're not taking any medication at all. The second point is the, I'm going to ask Dr. Keating to comment on this, because he had mentioned also the advantage of ibrutinib would be that it may not cause second cancers. I don't know if that's true or not, but FCR might. So I'm going to ask his opinion. But the third point, and just saying, being in Canada, if you to put a patient onto a drug that's going to cost $100,000 a year for life, is going to be an enormous toll to our system. And I know that really shouldn't influence us in making decisions, but the reality is it does. We only have so much money within our in our pockets to use for our cancer patients. So it is, that's a practical point we have to think about. Michael, can you ask, what about the second malignancies in your FCR patients out at 15 years?
Actually, there's a slow trickle of solid tumors, but it hasn't sort of bounced up. I think we're beginning to identify that there are different genetic subsets that tend to be predisposed to different types of second cancers. I personally think that the that there's a big element of immunosuppression that occurs in the Richter's transformation, for example, because they tend to occur in the first year to 2 years, whereas the time course of the AML MDSs tends to be around about 3 to 5 years, and then it tends to disappear. So the more time we have to gather the information, I think we'll be able to establish the patterns. It's a bit like Hodgkin's disease, that as time went by, the AML MDS began to appear around about that time, and then it flattened out and it didn't occur subsequently. So nowadays that we have so much genomic sequencing, we'll be able to go back to those patients, see if they have any predisposing lesion, which is common to them. Perhaps they have the SF3B1 before they go on to treatment. This predisposes to the MDS pattern. So I think it's something to be respected, but not necessarily feared. I think that what we're going to do with the FCR group is we're going to do FC is the best chemotherapy background, but we're going to use it with GA101 and also with ibrutinib to see if we can get most patients MRD negative at 3 months and then stop and see what happens by minimizing the exposure. But I will tell you that a number of the patients that that have had it either frontline on a heavy water study that we had or a couple of other smaller studies, they don't like being on the drug indefinitely. They're saying, how long do I need to stay on this? Can I get off it, et cetera, et cetera. So I don't think human beings like taking medication indefinitely. They're apprehensive about it.
I guess the only other comment I would make about that issue is there is interest in testing the drug further in clinical trials. Clinical trials are coming, evaluating ibrutinib in first line, and a number of centers throughout Canada will be involved as the NCIC clinical trials group participates in frontline ibrutinib studies. So there's going to be opportunities to further evaluate this, and ultimately, I suppose, the data from well-designed trials are going to be important to follow up on. The long-term follow-up has been identified as really, really critical in this case. We'll stick with ibrutinib for the next question. Maybe I'll pose this one to Dr. Lamanna. Following ibrutinib resistance, what next? Transplant, new drugs? Will ABT19 be effective when ibrutinib is no longer effective? What might the approach be in the setting of ibrutinib failure? Tough question to start off with.
Yeah, figures. For the loud New Yorker.
Welcome to the meeting.
So, I mean, obviously, part of that question also happens to be relevant to what somebody might have also seen before ibrutinib or not. If we're talking about primary failure to ibrutinib, there are other opportunities for clinical trials. ABT199, of course, is another agent that could be used in the setting of kinase failures. Of course, if the person is young enough, I think Michael had already touched upon this, depending upon allogeneic stem cell transplant is still obviously a very valid option for younger folks who are fitter and who there might be a donor available if they have kinase failures and their disease is progressing quite rapidly. So stem cell transplant is not out of the way yet for patients with CLL. Of course, some might argue that with a lot of these new agents, we're sort of going away from transplant, but still there's a very valid role for transplantation, particularly in some of the younger folks who are failing very good frontline therapies. In terms of older folks who might be failing some of the kinases, I think then you're looking to newer drugs because, of course, more aggressive combination chemoimmunotherapy regimens may not be applicable because you may have other comorbidities or be too frail to get them. I mean, typically we used to rely on, R-CHOP or EPOC or more, or FCRM or more aggressive regimens to salvage people who were failing some therapy. But I think that's going to be, of course, more difficult for the average age patient with CLL who might be failing a drug like ibrutinib. So you're really talking about new novel therapies. Potentially you might be salvaged with another kinase, although to be fair, I think we don't have all that data and we don't know how long, because if you're failing a kinase that is inhibiting one particular protein on the same pathway, we don't know if you'll be salvaged very long if you inhibit another one downstream. So that still remains to be seen. We have salvaged people from Idela with ibrutinib, but again, the data is very small and immature, so we don't know for how long that will be. So you're really trying to look for alternative agents that might be outside or different mechanisms of action against either the microenvironment or CLL that have escaped why you failed ibrutinib in the first place. So I think it's a very complicated answer. I don't know if it's very complicated, but certainly alternative choices would be what you would be looking for.
That's great. Is there any other comments from others on the panel? It is a complicated question.
You want to let me hang on that one? Okay.
are there any comments about the mechanism of resistance and whether that's relevant for the issue of alternative kinase therapies, or is there a way to, if you take, for example, the CML example where there may be the development of specific mutations, they may be able to overcome them. Is there any data about that in CLL?
There is. I mean, Michael talked about this a little bit, and I'll see if other members want to answer this as well. I mean, of course, we've identified a few mutations that can develop while you're on ibrutinib. However, I think Michael alluded to this earlier, there are many individuals who don't. So just because we have the testing that might identify a mutation doesn't mean that, we have the knowledge of why you failed the drug. So testing for that helps, but it doesn't help, at least right now. Yes? Correct. I'll let you go.
So it's too early to tell all the different types of resistance ibrutinib would have, but going to breast cancer, which had a long history of kinase inhibitors and resistance to them, what happens with these inhibitors over a long period of time is you get reprogramming of the kinases within these cells, and therefore they develop different pathways to getting resistance. And so the challenge will be trying to figure out which pathways are relevant and which ones are incidental. And it's just too early to tell right now.
I think that we tend to get a little mesmerized by the stochastic model of myeloid differentiation, that there's the myeloid stem cell and it goes through the maturation, then it gets to a neutrophil which gets into the tissues and it dies off. But in CLL, we know that in the immune system there are memory cells that can be reactivated by exposure to the same antigen that's driving it, so that they revert from being a memory cell to going back to being an activated B cell, that they begin to proliferate and respond in an anamnestic response. So we have this ton of cells that's floating around, and because we don't get to the point where we can't find any CLL cells very often, there are all these cells that are floating around, and we're not sure whether they can be recalled into service. So that they've already been through the proliferation phase where they needed the BTK, but subsequently, they're probably being driven by toll cell receptors, et cetera, and a number of other pathways that don't require the B cell receptor stimulation to occur. So that I think we need to get back to a little bit of the biology of what the B lymphocyte system is, rather than just saying, okay, there's a stem cell, it goes from there to there to there, we block that, everything's fine. It's just not fine. The thing that really surprised everyone was that if you look at the kids with Bruton's A gamma globulinemia that have the mutation, they can't make any B cells, and they can't make any gamma globulin. And yet we take people and we block this enzyme as well as we can. And they're still making the same amount of IgG and the same amount of IgA. I don't think that they can respond to a new antigenic stimulus. So if you were to get keyhole limpet hemocyanin and squirt it in, they probably couldn't make an IgM response to a neoantigen if they're on it. And one of the things that I think happens if we get people that get infections, I usually, that are not responding very quickly, I tell them to go off the ibrutinib to give their normal B cell population a chance to respond. So I think we have to think, A, there's a drug and there's a CLL cell, but there's a patient and then there's a whole biology of the lymphoid system that we have to integrate it in. One of the things that I don't know that we need to use the 420 milligram because we start off with a ton of CLL, which means we have a ton of BTK, and then they get down to a small amount, and we're still giving them the 420 milligram. So one of the things we're going to do start doing is measuring free ibrutinib, because I think if there's free ibrutinib floating around, there may be enzymes that have a lower affinity that will gradually accumulate things, and if you think of the TEC family of enzymes that's in the cardiac tissue, they might just need to pick up a little bit of ibrutinib along the way, and because they're not turning over very rapidly perhaps in the cardiac tissue, they're just accumulating things, and that may be the cause of all the off-target side effects. So we're going to see if we can look at occupancy and see if we can get people down to one tablet a day instead of three, and that'll make all the Canadians happy because it'll only cost a third as much. Perhaps we get every second day, or perhaps we give it by suppositories. And
the concept about resistance is, I'm always concerned resistance is a potential out there, but the concept that Dr. Keating mentioned about putting some drugs together as an induction, I mean, the drugs are generally pretty safe now, but putting them together in a compelling way, a big hard hit right at the beginning, get down to a point where there's very minimal residual disease left over, and then start going after the immune system to tidy that up, as opposed to this continuous suppression. And, you know, these are two very different conceptual ways of attacking this cancer. You know, when we treat acute leukemia, it's not typically going on for months or years. We go in hard, we get remission, we consolidate, and then we stop. So, you know, you sort of wonder about continuous suppression, really, if that is the way to go, or what's driving the appeal for that. As opposed to let's kill it off and give some immunotherapy, or I don't know about the CAR Ts, they can be pretty toxic, but yeah, let's go for cure and let's put it all up front and go for it.
Very good discussion. Sorry, that was just, no, that's very good. Very good discussion. Maybe we'll move away from the many ibrutinib questions just for a moment. So there's some questions about Richter's transformation. So I'll open this up for the panel, and because I know there won't be too many excited takers.
I refer all my patients to Nicole.
That's in New York, of course.
Perfect. So there's a few questions, but they can probably be lumped in together. So I think the first question, which is important, is what advances are there ongoing in treating Richter's? And along with that, how long have you seen Richter's patients survive? And another question about after frontline treatment with R-CHOP, what would you do next? So that's kind of... maybe starting with the frontline therapy, and maybe that's getting to the issue of transplant. I'm not too sure. Are there any new advances, and maybe the question about how long have you seen patients survive is perhaps around the issue of curability. Who wants to tackle that?
I'm happy to do that. Thank you. So Richter's has always been a difficult issue, actually. MD Anderson has published a few publications, of course, limited in patients who have had multiple prior therapies for their CLL and develop Richter's transformation. It's usually a very, very poor outcome, and I think that's been said earlier on today. There's no doubt that if a patient in that setting develops Richter's transformation, depending upon what kind of chemotherapies or immunotherapies they might have seen, of course, the goal is to try to get them in remission, and if they are young and fit enough, yes, that's a group I do advocate go to allogeneic stem cell transplant. Now, my only caveat to that, of course, are patients who might develop Richter's transformation early on. In other words, they've never had treatment for their CLL, and in my belief, they act more like de novo large cell lymphoma patients, and those patients actually can be cured of their large cell component. Their CLL still remains and will come back to haunt them, but those are a group that can be salvaged, and I don't necessarily take those folks to transplant. So if you develop Richter's and haven't had a lot of therapy and or actually any therapy for your CLL, you can be cured of your large cell component, and those are the people that I will follow aggressively. But I think there are some, I don't know if anybody wants to tackle more of that, there are some new agents being looked at. You know, previously prior to the kinases, of course, we were always talking about the patients with 17p and p53. And mind you that de novo, that's a small group, right? So 17p is not so common to be diagnosed with if you're upfront for CLL. It's about 6 to 7% of the population. But certainly that incidence rises as you get more resistance along the way, and it's about a third of patients that you see sort of patients evolve and become more resistant to therapies. So there are a bunch of new agents being looked at for patients with Richter's now, hopefully. There are clinical trials running, so obviously I think that's really important as we're grappling with how do we use these agents and what are the long-term pharmacoeconomic, including toxicities of some of these new drugs. Clinical trials, I think, are key to get some of these agents approved, and obviously for certain different countries going over their regulatory boards about how to push those drugs forward to get them to you. So there are clinical trials of new drugs, BCL2-like receptors and so on and so forth being looked at for Richter's.
I think one of the things that perhaps Spence might comment on is I think it's important that we get some sense of how big the problem is and coordinate it, because you know, there are very few places that see enough Richter's to be able to mount a program. And the problem is to make the diagnosis and then get a homogeneously treated population. Our CHOP doesn't work. You know, it's just boring as heck. You just give it, and their hair falls out, and their counts go down. Their LDH comes up again, and they don't recover their normal counts, etc. And it just doesn't work. I think that there are a couple of things. Dr. Davida Rossi published in Blood that about 80 to 85% of the patients, that if you sequence them, you can find that the sequence identifies that they've evolved from the CLL cell. So the CLL cell has been damaged and something bad has happened. If you do the cytogenetics, the regular karyotyping on those patients, you usually get 3 or 4 lines of abnormalities. So thinking that a single agent that blocks an enzyme is going to work is silly. So we either have to attack it from a metabolic point of view or a kinetic point of view or an immunophenotypic point of view, because they maintain their surface antigenicity. A rider on this is that I never do PET scans on people with CLL at all unless I think they've got Richter's. And in that circumstance, even if morphologically it's not Richter's, if they have an SUV of 10 or greater, they've got something akin to Richter's, and they will succumb as quickly. So that we're beginning to learn a little more about the biology. There are a few patients that actually, driven by the Epstein-Barr virus, and can spontaneously resolve. And there are a number of patients that can be cured by transplant. But so far we, particularly in the United States, you know, when we talk about cooperative groups, we ought to be the North American non-cooperative groups. We, you know, the Germans are terrific. You know, Michael Halleck says, we will get up and we will do this protocol, and you will put all of your patients on the protocol, and they will all respond, and they will have no response, no toxicity. And then they will tell us when they die so that we can complete our follow-up. Now, can you imagine anything like that happening in North America? Not a chance.
Where can I go from there? But I totally agree with Dr. Keating that this is collaboration. Yeah, whatever he said. That the reason is that there's very few of these patients that we see, so we have to work collaboratively to bring this around. And we're going to actually see more of it as patients receive more and more different types of therapies that cause damage to CLL. And if you don't cure it, then maybe we will see more rictus formation as we see with other types of cancer. In that regard, we have to keep our eye on the ball in order to collaborate to see what's going on and then develop more therapies. And that's really all I have to add.
Because remember, CLL patients are living longer.
The other thing that's happening with the ABT, and to a lesser degree with the ibrutinib, is that we're seeing a number of patients that are having plasmablastic lymphoma, which used to be as rare as rocking horse manure. So, you know, we just didn't see it. Now there's all of a sudden there's a cluster. So Dr. Tam and Dr. Stilgenbauer and our people are deliberately going out of their way every time they see something like that to collect the samples and start sharing them globally. Because, as I said earlier, the venetoclax or the ABT-199, the commonest cause of failure is a transformation event. You also have to realize that Richter described large cell lymphoma as the transformation. But a number of these patients actually have Hodgkin's transformation. Some of them have T-cell transformations. Occasional patient will develop a Burkitt-type translocation. So it's very important for us to get morphology as well as the genetic sequencing that to try and identify it.
I'm just really going to reiterate, but I just want to, one of the difficulties I have is that whether a patient has a transformation of CLL to a diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, really which is what is Richter's, or whether they just happen to have CLL and a diffuse large B-cell lymphoma at the same time. They're both commonly called Richter's transformation. And so we have to be very careful because there certainly are probably 20% of our patients where they have two separate diseases at the same time. So if you go in and you're told that you have Richter's, you shouldn't immediately panic because you may actually have two separate diseases. And if you do have two separate diseases, then you will respond to R-CHOP. What we're talking about, the really bad prognosis is where after you've had CLL for a number of years, perhaps have had FCR, then it transforms to a bad disease. But I think it's, and I also reiterate the importance of getting a biopsy to confirm the diagnosis. So that's what we do. We do if there's a concern about, and I've had some CLL patients sent to me, and things just don't fit. I do a PET scan, and you find that the lymph nodes in the neck don't take up. They have a low, what's called an SUV, and then the lymph nodes in the tummy are different. They've got a high SUV. And they are diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. And I've got a number of patients like that, and they've done very well. They obviously had two separate diseases. I saw them at diagnosis, and those patients have had their lymphoma cured with R-CHOP. So I think it's important. And do your pathologists, are they inclined to call them all Richter's? Or they're good, they separate them? Ours are not so good, so. Maybe yours aren't either, so.
It's how powerful the PET scan is lighting up. So on my hematology exams, you always had to get a biopsy for Richter, so that was the right answer, even with the PET coming along. But of course, you know, large cell lymphoma has changed a bit too. You know, these dual hit lymphomas, we're starting to think about autologous transplants or potentially dose-adjusted EPOC and things like that. So within the world of large cell lymphoma, things are changing. You know, do you have a FISH c-MYC mutation? Are you a triple hit? Do any of those things factor into somebody with a Richter's?
No data. I haven't seen anyone break it out like that.
Very good. I think so. We've got about just over 10 minutes left in this session, so maybe we'll try to roll through a couple of simpler questions so we can get a few more of your questions answered. So, this is a simple, I think, a straightforward question, maybe for Ronan, for Dr. Foley. So, is subcutaneous IVIG available in Ontario, Quebec, the rest of Canada?
Is the mutation enough?
Sorry, the subcutaneous IVIG, subcutaneous immunoglobulin.
Yes, yeah. Yes, it is. My nurse Karen Running presented it all to me. So it's Hizenza, I believe, is the term for it. It's a very comprehensive program. You know, this is one of the things, if your gamma globulin levels are low and you're getting a lot of infections, it's a pretty safe, effective way to boost, jack up your immune system. Because nobody wants to get an infection. So, it looks good to me, Graeme. I'm just starting to put people on it in Ontario, but maybe we're behind, as always.
Yeah, well, I think we'll hear some more about it tomorrow morning, the Manitoba experience. But yes, it is available in Ontario as well.
I think that one of the things that Steve Mulligan from Sydney reported was that there was a much stronger correlation of the risk of infections with deficiency of the subclasses of IgG rather than the absolute IgG. Mm. And there's IgG 1, 2, 3, and 4, and some people will have a normal absolute level of IgG, but an absolute deficiency of one of them. And that's probably an indication, but I'd probably like to ask people to comment on, do they think that the subcutaneous actually is clinically better? Because a number of my patients that have had intravenous and have changed over the subcutaneous say they have less infections. And when asked why that might be, you know, I think, well, it's a large molecule. We give it intravenously. It gets taken up probably by splenic tissue filtering the blood. It might get to the marrow. I don't think it gets into many of the lymph glands. Whereas if you give it subcutaneously, it's taken up by lymphatic channels, and it probably has to go through the whole lymphatic channel pathway. And if opsonization and delivery of activated antigen-presenting cells, et cetera, is important, it may be that it's the preferred mechanism of administration rather than just being cheaper and easier to give.
Sounds like a new
clinical. Sounds like.
Well, and there's similar thoughts about subcutaneous rituximab. And a little bit of teasing evidence that maybe sub-Q, because you're going right into the lymphatics as the administrative route, that you're going right into where the lymphoma cells live. So It might be better. I think patients prefer it, not even a maybe. They prefer to do it that way. So patient preference, and it's an important drug.
Oops. Good. So a question for Dr. Johnston. I think maybe this came up in your session, the last breakout session. So the question about ibrutinib availability in our country and what the expectation is for access and approval and coverage for it. Do you have any, it's a bit of a speculative question, but do you have any thoughts?
Yeah, you probably would you may know better than me, or maybe Ronan does. I mean, right now we can get it on exceptional basis for our patients, and so that's what we have been busily doing. I think we were told that we have until June or July to get people on, and if we can get our patients on by then, the company has guaranteed that they will supply the drug for the rest of the patient's life. So we have been busy. I don't know if they wanted me to advertise that, but I have been busy identifying all the patients who I thought may benefit from ibrutinib. But I don't know what's going to happen in June or July, and it's not even... The problem is going to be the provinces. I mean, it's every province is going to have different criteria, and Manitoba is very different to Ontario. When we get patients from Ontario coming to see us, it's a nightmare, because what we may want to do, it may not be funded in Ontario. And this is going to be an issue across the country with ibrutinib, and I think I can just see it, that we'll all be competing with each other, so that who's going to approve ibrutinib, and then we use that as leverage to get our government, because they say, well, they pay for it in Saskatchewan, so we should have it in Manitoba. But and that's how these drugs are obtained across the country. They're not. It's
a challenge.
Issue. Yeah. Have you any ideas of in Ontario?
So I think there's similar uncertainty. Certainly, I mean, as I think most of you know, there has been a favorable recommendation through the P-Coder process, and it's now at the provincial level. There's been some speculation that it is being looked at just now for funding in Ontario, and some speculation and optimism that there will be coverage available in the coming months, but the timing is unclear, and the specific the specific indication is also a little bit unclear. Generally speaking, it's been dictated by the eligibility criteria and results from the clinical data that was being reviewed, but there are extenuating circumstances here that I think make a little more uncertainty. So I think we are hopeful, but again, it's not clear, and I think there's similar uncertainty across the country.
I think one of the difficulties is that you have to appreciate is that in the cancer centers, that it's all provincially funded, so you have so many dollars that you can use for your cancer drugs, and so we're competing. We're competing with the groups who treat melanoma, and they've got all of these new antibodies now, which are incredibly expensive and appear to be highly efficacious. So we're all competing one against the other for the same pot of money. So it makes it very difficult. Our committees have all said, yes, we agree that all of these drugs should be funded, but whether they will be or not is up to the government funding, and whether we can, whether our different governments are in the red or the black. So we'll hope that they're going to be in the right side.
You know, perhaps there's a new industry, because in the Second World War, when penicillin was in such short supply, they used to collect all the urine and recycle it. The patients that are taking, perhaps people in the U.S. could sell their urine, and you could distill it off and get a ibrutinib and...
sell it to Canada.
Sell it to Canada. You can send the oil down on the pipeline, and we'll send the urine back in the other direction.
That's very, very
cancer
innovative.
Cancer is a serious topic. We should.
That's fantastic. Good. What else do you say? So I've got there's a question about comorbidity. I don't know if perhaps, Susan, Dr. Leclair, do you want to? So there's a question about how might comorbidities influence treatment decisions. Do you feel comfortable answering that?
No, that was my question.
Was it? Oh, okay. It's a Tough one.
Everybody today kept talking about, well, comorbidities influence this, comorbidities influence that. The logical question to me was, which? Is it more or less good to have type 2 diabetes than cardiovascular disease? Is it more or less good to have gout instead of osteoarthritis? Is it more or less good to, I don't know, be a couch potato as opposed to the lady that frightened me on the screen with the flying, yeah, with the yoga position, yes. Because I didn't think that was possible, so.
Not with earrings on, anyway. The comorbidities, so when we're actually working out comorbidities, there's a whole sheet that we use, and it's called the SIRS. And you're given points according to the status. So if you've got type 2 diabetes, you might get 1. And then if you're on metformin, then that's another 1. And then if you need insulin, then might be 3. So it is graded according to the severity of your illness. So it's a bit tedious. You have to go through and sort of calculate for each person. And it's the same, for example, with past malignancies. Have the malignancies, was it over 5 years ago? Was it within 5 years? Was it surgically resected? Did you need chemotherapy? So it's not as simple as just adding up whether you have got gout or a peptic ulcer. You have to grade it, the severity within each group. And then you're given a point. And if you have, this is from Dr. Halleck's work, so if you've got less than 6 points, then you would be eligible for FCR. Does Dr. Keating believe in comorbidities and the value with FCR, or should everybody get FCR?
Well, I don't think I'd be eligible for any of the German studies. Seriously, the SIR score was just a geriatric score. It wasn't developed on CLL, and I've been suggesting to our fellows that we actually begin to look at things that we think are important. Renal function's important. If you have a high uric acid, it probably means that something bad is happening to cell turnover. When we talk about having abnormal lipids and statins, it's really very interesting because people with CLL have an inordinately high number of people with hypercholesterolemia and hyperlipidemia, and they shift over to a lipid metabolism, but they still don't have a whole unusual spectrum of cardiac or cerebrovascular disease. So, a score has to mean something. The reason we have definitions of complete remission was when they were developing it in childhood leukemia, they found if the kids had got treated, something happened to the patients that were living and something didn't happen to the others, it meant something. So it was an observation between good and bad people, and then they began to look at whether that had any impact. And I think the SIR score is a hallucination of the Germans. I never used the SIR score, ever.
That's a good point. Outside of a clinical trial, there's the Charleston scale, I think, and the Sears, but no one ever uses them. And they're old. I mean, those things have been around forever. The treatment of CLL kind of gets thrown into this fit, unfit, frail. And every talk you go to the CLL, this is the guidelines for these people and these people and these people. But when I go and look at notes in the ward or in the clinic, there's no SIRS score outside of a clinical trial. So, I think Adelisib in Canada is going to be, you got to be SIRS 6, but people, what's a SIRS score? So I don't know how you determine fitness. One of my colleagues said, if they can get up on the examining table, go and just give them the treatment. That's good enough.
I'm accepting referrals of any patients of Ronan's.
Treat them all.
So we're going to finish up with one final question. I think, again, a little bit off the topics we've covered so far. So somebody would like to know, after chemotherapy treatment, with FCR and the example of the question, is it useful to take vitamins, herbal supplements? Are there any dietary or lifestyle modifications that may be useful after chemotherapy? I'll maybe just open that up to the panel entirely. All of a sudden, the microphone's a hot potato.
As a non-MD, I can basically say that have a healthy lifestyle after you're in remission. Exercise, eat well, basically do what everyone else should have done when they before they get cancer to reduce your cancer risk.
So people ask me all the time, should I have green tea? And I say, well, you can have 18 cups of green tea a day or 2 glasses of red wine. Take your pick. And they're not drinking the tea. So,
In all seriousness, I think it's a very good question. We get asked, what can I do? Obviously, because this is, for the most part, many of you are being monitored and watched, and you want to do something active. And I think what you said was actually very relevant. Things that take care of your organ function in general that are good, that are going to benefit your health in general, are probably good for your CLL in the long run. We obviously have no specific studies outside of the green tea that Michael was referring to by our colleagues at the Mayo. Clearly, there's a lot of what we don't know. And you hear 1 year, one glass of wine is okay. Oh, no, two are okay. What about dark chocolate? And what about regular chocolate? A little bit too much, So we just don't know. We don't have all these studies. And what might be relevant for one cancer might not be good for another cancer.
What do you do with vitamin D?
Yeah.
There you go.
Well.
There you go. Right.
Yeah.
So we have lots of things that we need to address going forward. So I always tell my folks, I think moderation is good. So what Michael is saying is very correct. Moderation in everything. I think if people are interested in doing supplements, as long as somebody is, whether it be, in my case, it's usually with me. But if you have an internist or somebody who's monitoring your organ function, because some of these supplements can cause damage to your liver or your kidney function, that's not what we want to do. So if you're going to do something alternatively when you're not on chemoactive therapy, you should discuss it with your physician. It's very important.
I think the vitamin D, I think, is a very important. There have been 2 studies showing that if your vitamin D level is low, then it's a shorter time to treatment and you'll have more advanced disease. And actually, we've done the same study in Winnipeg and got the same findings. It doesn't mean that taking vitamin D is going to change the course of the disease, but when we have checked in our clinic, 70% of our patients, and it's not just during the winter. When we look through every month of the year, we still detect vitamin deficiency. And in fact, the lowest level I saw this year was a man who had a level of 20. He was a soccer player. He played outside in all summer, and yet his level was extremely low. So we advise everybody to take vitamin D, and we tell everybody to take 2,000 units a day or 3,000 units to correct their level. I don't have any proof that it makes a difference, but I that's what I do. I don't know if anybody else.
The vitamin D story really played out in prevention of breast cancer, and I was chairing a few grant panels where it's just very hard to do a population study and come up with a crisp answer. There's beautiful scientific data, compelling stuff why it should work, but the population studies are hard. I just wonder, Spencer, is there a way to kind of, in that space you're in with all those samples, is there a way to kind of suss out what people are doing, especially in the pre-treatment stage, and sort of get some biomarkers back that maybe things are happening if you do this or that, rather than trying to engage in a 20,000 patient study? Does any of that make sense to you? I mean, you've got the tools potentially to do that. Or if there's interest from the public.
So you put the gauntlet down. When we've actually done some of these studies looking at vitamin D levels and levels of other factors that might contribute to cancer progression, that it's very difficult because CLL patients, in particular, are very open to taking all kinds of supplements. So if you're taking vitamin D beforehand and you go into study and you have high vitamin D, but you might actually be low beforehand, how do we correct for that? And how do we correct for what it was before you're diagnosed to after you're diagnosed. And so it's very hard to tease out all these issues. We do know that vitamin D levels in CLL patients are low, but we also know it's low in the general population in Canada because it just it's not enough sun up here. So it's a difficult area to tackle.
I think that one of the things we forget is that vitamin D is a fat-soluble vitamin, and there's so much disturbance of fat metabolism in CLL that maybe that it's just a byproduct of the disturbed metabolism. One of the things that surprised us was there's a lot of prognostic information about lipoprotein lipase, and it's as good or better than ZAP70. And if you actually don't do an alcohol wash and stain CLL cells for fat, there's just stuffed with fat globules. And if you go back to the ancient electron microscopy days in the 1960s, all of the EMs in CLL had all these vacuoles that were just fat. So is it just that the CLL cells are just sucking up fat and storing it there, and whether it's doing anything is really debatable?
Very good. Well, we're just past 5 p.m., so I think we will let our panel off the hook. A big round of applause for the panel.